we don't take for granted our praise and worship team. You know, they come out every Friday night. You know, the most precious night of the week sometimes, Friday night. They come out every Friday night to practice, and they hear Wednesdays and Sundays faithfully. We do not take you for granted. God bless you all. Amen. All those sound good. I heard you. Sound good, brother. I like that. Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to the house of our God. The series that we are involved with is Experiencing the Heart of Jesus, with the general title, True Victory. What we have handed out this evening, if you have your notes, we have about maybe 12 subcategories for this book or series. The first subcategory is experiencing the care of Jesus. And I don't have my book, but under experiencing the care of Jesus, there should have been like your first two or three lessons. Does anybody have a completed book? I can just take a minute and organize this. Do you have a completed book? What's the first lesson we have? The God we can trust. Okay, that's under experiencing the care. The next one is? Okay, that's also care. The next one? God's gift to the world. That's under peace. And then after that is?
True peace.
And after that is? He dismissed the crowd. Great. Thank you. Both under peace. Now tonight, we're going to do the first teaching under the heading Experiencing the Grace of Jesus. And what you'll see throughout the course of the year, there will be 12 of these subgroupings. So we're on our third one, which is Experiencing the Grace of Jesus. And we should, you know, have about two or three lessons with that one. So the title of tonight is The Royal Pauper. The Royal Pauper. It's an oxymoron. The two shouldn't really go together, the royal pauper. But it seems as if that's how we live our lives as children of God. We are children of God. We are sons and daughters of the King. There is royalty in the room, and far too often we live and we talk like we're paupers. Now, you don't have to give me a witness, because I know I wouldn't want a witness over that, but I think the title is true. The Royal Paupers. And perhaps by the time this evening is over, I know we won't resolve it tonight, but we'll begin to resolve the issue. The Royal Pauper. And it's in regard to the grace of God. The grace of God. You know, we're going to read through some of these notes this evening, and what we have discovered is this. The grace of God is so good that it seems too good to be true. The goodness of God is so absolute and divine that we mere mortals have a tendency to put disclaimers on it and requirements to it because it's just too good to be true. That's the grace of God. Because it's so rich and full, we put requirements on it, and that's what turns us into a royal pauper. Because it's so good, but I just don't deserve it. And I know none of you have ever thought that before, but from time to time, yes. So let's look at our verse. Our verse today, well, there's several of them, but we're going to start with Romans chapter 5, and I'm going to ask that we can just mix it up and start from the back row. So Michael Kozlowski, I'll ask you to start the reading. Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 11, and if you'll read two verses, and we'll just read that first passage and go from there.
Okay. And we were unable to help ourselves at the moment of our need, Christ died for us, although we were living against God. Very few people will die to save the life of someone else, although perhaps for a good person someone might possibly die.
God shows his great love for us in his way. Christ died for us while we were still sinners. And sin by his...
By his blood.
By his blood he did not... He did all this for us as sinners. How much more will he do for us now that he has declared us not guilty? Now he will save us from all of God's wrath And since, when we were his enemies, we were brought back to God by the death of his Son, what blessings he must have for us now that we are his friends and he is living within us. Now we rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, all because of what our Lord Jesus Christ has done in dying for our sins, making us friends of God.
Thank you, Jude. That is a beautiful passage. And you notice the translation's a little different. I like to look at different translations because, you know, it's like reading for the first time again. Sometimes, you know, we read things and we just gloss over it. We lose the power of it. Okay, the Royal Pauper. Let's first look down at Roman numeral number 1, and maybe I can read that, or you can read that first few sentences with me. It says in our notes, deep down we often believe what Jesus has done for us may be too good to be true. This is by far, I believe, the most common objection to grace. It's just too good to be true. There has to be requirements involved. Sometimes we just think that we have overextended our credit line with God. Anybody ever think that way sometimes? Good, you won't. Because the interesting thing is that the following statement, the vast majority of people simply state what you have stated. God may give grace to you, but not to me. I believe in the grace of God. However, my circumstances are different. You see, I have used up my amount of failures. You ever think you just used up your amount of failures? I have failed in this area way too many times. I give up on myself. I declare myself a knockout. Yeah, and then we all think like that. We have said that I have pushed the envelope too many times, and we also are tempted to say that I am not your typical sinner. I am guilty of, and I put the slashes in the middle because I don't want you to fill in the blank here. I do not want you to fill in that blank. That's why the slashes are in the middle. We might say, I am guilty of... Pause. Let's pause there. This statement you have made, may have said yourself, these ideas, these beliefs, I have fought them. And you have fought them, right?
Yep.
Thanks. But we think that we're the only ones who fought them. We think we're the minority. But it's not. That's the majority. That is really the common thinking of fallen humanity. We believe that God is good, it's just that we're too bad to get the goodness of God. So let's fill in some blanks here tonight. Right underneath it, it says, when we were blank. Does anybody know what that word might be?
Unable.
When we were unable. You can fill it in if you like. When we were unable to help
ourselves.
Ourselves. How true is that? I'll say amen for you. Amen.
Amen.
When we were, what's the blank? When we were living against who?
God.
Interesting. And at the very moment of our greatest need. At the very moment of our greatest need. The gospel of grace. The gospel of grace. Grace came when we were unable to save ourselves. Grace came. Grace came when we were living not for him, not even, you know, impartial to him. Grace came when we were living against him. Grace came. And Scripture says that was our moment of greatest need. When we weren't even looking for him, when we were against him, he loved us, he saved us, he died for us.
Yeah.
Amazing. And it says that if God died for us, when we've said this before, if he died for us while we were at our worst, why on earth do we think that we are so unacceptable to him now that we're trying a little bit? You know, we start to try a little bit, and I'm being gracious to everybody here. As we become Christians, we try, Brandy, just a little bit. We try to try just a little bit to please our God and to please each other even less still. But prior to that, we had no desire. And if it's not you personally, it's humanity in general. Prior to that, humanity had no desire to please God. We were, quite frankly, against him. When we were against him, he loved us. He died for us. He forgave us. Now that we're trying, why on earth do we think we're getting it all wrong? And why do we think that God is so displeased and angry with us? And that's what this passage is primarily saying. So therefore, he is saying this. He's saying you're living as royal paupers. You have the riches of the kingdom, but you won't allow yourself to enjoy the benefits of the kingdom. And as always, you are too hard on yourself. And when you're too hard on yourself, you know what, don't stay there, right? Because if I'm miserable, I guarantee you I'll do my best to make sure you're miserable. If I'm not happy just by default, I'm not going to be happy with you either. Sorry, Joe. And that's why the passage says, my goodness, while you were at your worst, he died for you. Let's look at that a little bit more. It says, verse 8. But God shows his great love for us in this way. Christ died while we were still sinners. Verse 9. And since by his blood he did all this for us as sinners. Now, how much more, not less, how much more will he do for us? Now that he already has declared us not guilty. He already got you at your worst and called you not guilty. Now that he has washed you and called you not guilty, what do you think is left for you? Well, the following sentence really answers it. It says, now he will save you from God's wrath to come. If you have an understanding of the grace of God, you will never, ever, ever think that God is angry with you or is going to deal with you on a day called Judgment Day in a negative kind of a way. Judgment Day, as far as I'm concerned, was the cross. That was Judgment Day. He paid every debt, destroyed every enemy, forgave every sin. And the judgment was through our Lord Jesus Christ. Your judgment is and always will be not guilty. Not guilty. And it is not based upon what you do. You are not guiltless because you do the right thing. Can I get a witness? You are guiltless. And know this, you are guiltless because Jesus paid the price. It is not that the standard has changed. Oh, nothing matters anymore? Incorrect. The standard never changed. This is the standard. It is eternal. Amen. Never, ever changes. But I thought I was free. You are free. You're free to love him. And if you love him and everybody else, you will fulfill this.
Amen.
You are free to love. The standard never changed. Just because Jesus died for your sin and my sin doesn't mean the standard changed. Doesn't mean I can live carelessly now and live just a sera sera. Doesn't mean that. But it does mean if I do live a sera sera, I am still guiltless because it was never based upon my works to start with. Amen. I still have a clear conscience based upon the blood of Jesus, not the blood of Michael. The blood of Michael does not clean me. The blood of Jesus does. Right?
Yes.
And that's where grace and truth comes in. Scripture says, you know, the law came by Moses, right? But grace and truth, it's not just grace. Grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. So grace is spread abroad and love is spread abroad in your hearts, but it never changes the truth of the matter. Right? It's just that you're not guilty anymore. And believe it or not, that is the active ingredient that will cause you to change your behavior. We don't believe that. I don't believe that sometimes, you know? You know, like Paul says, what are you doing? Giving people license to sin? Can I sin now that grace may abound? It's an age-old question. We don't believe in the power of God that if you extend grace, it will cause us to stop doing the wrong thing. We don't believe that. We believe you gotta do the oomph to get the what you need. And that will never happen. It will never, ever happen. You can lay down the law. It will never get our desired results. There's only one way to get them, through grace. If I love you, forgive you, love you, forgive you, love you, eventually our behaviors will change. That's what Scripture says. I don't have to teach you the law. I don't have to tell you, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. If you're doing that, it's all covenant, and it's only going to bring death. Scripture says you bring death when you do that. You bring death every time you go into somebody's life and say, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. That brings death. Scripture says that. But we don't believe that. That's why we still say that. We don't believe it. You know why? Because grace is too good to be true. And that's why we're royal paupers. Because grace is too good to be true. Grace can't work. It's the only thing that can work. That's why Jesus came, to bring grace and truth. Amen?
Amen.
Until we believe these simple principles of the good news, we will continue to live as royal paupers, children of God, but not enjoying the benefits of the kingdom. Okay, so somebody read for us the next verse here, Joel chapter 2, verses 13 and 14.
Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful. He is not easily angered. He is filled with kindness and is eager not to punish you. Who knows, perhaps even yet he will give you a reprieve, sending you a blessing instead of this terrible curse. Perhaps he will give you so much that you will be able to offer grain and wine to the Lord your God as before.
Thank you, Tiger. Perfect. Okay, before we look at that once again, the title of tonight is Royal Paupers, because in the minds of the vast majority, we believe the grace of God is too good to be true. Therefore, we put disclaimers on it and qualifiers on it. And even a simple qualifier, like unless you say a certain prayer, you do not receive the blessings of heaven. The blessings of heaven have been given to you by the Lord Jesus Christ. Your prayer comes into agreement with it, but you had it before you said that. Even that, the simple term of salvation, as we call it, we think it has to be achieved through an effort of our own. He gave you salvation. He gave it to you. It's a gift of God. And you see, until we understand just how wonderful this grace is, how wonderful, how easy, how free, how simple. This is like only God can do this. No human being would give this kind of grace. Because we call it sloppy, we call it ineffective. We I mean, my goodness. I mean, does anybody agree with me?
Yeah.
You know, because we, the human mind, we like words like responsibility, accountability, you know. Get it together, you gotta, you know, work. And if we think about it, as always, the lawgiver himself, the one who instituted the law, Moses, he couldn't even keep it. Why do we perpetuate it upon each other? Jesus came to bring grace, because it is only through grace that we will fulfill this. He came to bring grace, the secret ingredient. The secret ingredient is grace. Remember that. How does truth get fulfilled in your life, in your family's life, in the life of the world? You need the secret ingredient. Grace. You give things to people that they don't deserve. You give them love and forgiveness again and again and again, so on and so forth. So the interesting thing here is in the book of Joel, in the Old Testament, it says, return to the Lord. Another way, or another word that you can use for return to the Lord is this, repent. Change the way you think. Joel is saying this. You need to change the way you think. He said it in the Old Covenant. Change the way you think. Because back in those days, he's addressing a group here. here, and he's saying, you think that God is so angry with you. You're hiding from God. You're running from him. You're not talking to him. You're not getting involved with the blessings because you think God is angry with you. And that's what Joel says in the Old Testament. You've got to change the way you think. You've got to change your mind. And then if he says, change the way you think, what does he say? He says, your God is gracious. We're all living in hell because we don't believe that. We're living as royal paupers because we don't believe he's gracious. Or we believe that we should be God because he's too gracious and someone has to crack the whip around here. Who's in charge around here? Bunch of weak individuals. Let me take care of this. You do this, you do this, you stop doing that. You know. Okay, all right. Change your mind. You don't know God. You know man. You know man made God, but you don't know God. God is gracious. What else does it say? Not me. He's merciful. What else does it say? He is not easily angered. Wow. It goes on. It says he is filled with kindness. Get this one. And is eager. Some of us scratch the word not out of our Bibles. And we use this on ourselves and others especially. He is eager to punish you. Let me say that. The word not is there. Can you read it, Bill? He says that he is eager not to punish you. God don't want to punish you. But he's a holy God. I know. That's why we're holy. Because he is holy. He made me holy. He made you holy. You didn't make you holy. Oh, I thought I made. No, you didn't make you holy. Randy, you can't make you holy. He can. When will he do that? On the cross. He did. He can. He did. So he is not eager to punish you. Don't you find this interesting? This is in the book of Joel. It's not even in the gospel. It's hundreds and hundreds of years before the gospel. He says, change your mind. You don't know God. He's gracious, he's merciful, he's kind, and he is not eager to punish you. Why? We don't even preach that today. We don't even preach that today. And especially to those who irritate us. Lord, Lord. So he is not eager to punish you. That's why we live like royal paupers. Because the grace is there, but we won't take it, and we sure won't give it. And look at 14. I like the humor in Joel. Joel is known as a strong prophet. Check out his humor. He says, who knows, everybody? Who knows? Perhaps what? Perhaps even he will reprieve you, and he'll send you a blessing. I don't know. He's being very whimsical here. He says, who knows? Hey. God just might want to bless you. He might reprieve you. He just may forgive you. And instead of punishing you, he wants to bless you. When you deserve hell, he's going to give you heaven. When you deserve sorrow, he's going to give you joy. When you deserve pain. It's like the Rocky Balboa match. It's like, Rocky, no, it was Mr. T. What's your prediction for the fight? Pain. That's how we see our life. What's your prediction in life? Pain and lots of it. And Joel says, you got to change your mind. You don't know God. Hey, if you start talking to God, you might find out that he wants to bless you and reprieve you and not give you as your actions deserve. Look at this. He says he might want to send you a blessing instead of a terrible curse. He's being whimsical. He said, God's not sending you a terrible curse. God is never sending you a terrible curse. He died to take the curse from you. Why do we think God's sending the curse? He died to remove it from you. For cursed is everyone who hangs upon a tree. So he hung upon a tree. He was cursed for you. As a matter of fact, not only does he want to not curse you, he took your curse. He was cursed for you. There's nothing left for you but blessing, no matter what you do. And let's not go back. but it doesn't get you the benefits of the kingdom. He gives you the benefits of the kingdom. What you do matters. Of course it does. Because you bring sorrow to yourself, you bring pain to yourself when you do those things. Yeah. But you're still loved by God. He's still not angry with you. If God, this is so interesting. I found this interesting. If God was angry with you, if God was ever angry with anybody in the world, that means he is a God that changes. He's a God that changes. Because then sometimes he's happy with you, and sometimes he's angry with you. That means he changes. You see, God doesn't change. Man changes. Sometimes Bill loves me, and sometimes he hates me, because he's a man. But God always loves me. God is never angry with me. Because then we could not call him the immutable, unchangeable God. Then he changes as often as we do with the direction of the wind, with the weather, with everybody's situation. And he's always changing. He's happy, he's sad, he's mad, he's glad. No, that's not God, that's man. And we made a God fashioned in the image and likeness of man and bowed down before it and said, ah, this is God. No, it's not God. Stop bowing to it. Joel said this. And then it says, this is really beautiful. It's what a beautiful passage. Perhaps he will give you so much. Huh. Not only is he not going to punish you, perhaps your God is going to give you so much that you will be able to offer grain and wine to the Lord as you did before. Perhaps you and I, our minds will be changed. Well, we'll start to believe that we're rich and prosperous and blessed by God. Well, we stop living in a resentful, critical kind of a lifestyle, and we just live giving. Giving, giving everything, giving all of our resources. We give because we're blessed. We just give freely. Freely we give. Freely give what? Primarily, freely give love, and freely give forgiveness. Primarily. And I guarantee you, if you freely give love and forgiveness, everything else falls out of you. Yeah. If you are only aware of the goodness of God, it would change your attitude, but you would give more offerings to God. And it's all of the above. You just start to give because you know you're so blessed. It's interesting that this is written in the Old Testament, where it says, you know, he's not angry, and who knows, perhaps. Perhaps all he wants to do is just bless you. Interesting? Mm-hmm. Let's spend a little more time here. Look at Romans chapter 5, and maybe somebody can pick it up. We'll read a couple of verses each. Take your time. Let's read that passage. Romans chapter 5, verses 14 through 19. Somebody start us?
And what is the difference between our sin and God's gracious gift? For this one man, Adam, brought death to many through his sin, but the other man, Jesus Christ, brought forgiveness to many through the God's bountiful gift.
And the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of that one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation, but we have the free gift of being accepted by God, even though we are guilty of many sins. The sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over us, but all who receive God's wonderful, gracious gift of righteousness will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ.
Yes. Adam's one sin brought condemnation upon everyone, but Christ's one act of righteousness make all people right in God's sight and gives them life. Because one person disobeyed God, many people became sinners. But because one person obeyed God, many people made right in God's sight.
Okay. I'm sure you're familiar with the passage, and hopefully this version helps us see a little clearer. You know, it says that we're contrasting sin and grace here. And all too often, unfortunately, the church more than the world, I think, we give such power to sin. We give more power to sin than we give to grace. We think that sin has such a powerful effect to bring death and sorrow and hell and torment. But Scripture says you can't compare sin to grace. And we don't even live in an era of sin. We live in an era of grace, yet we still perpetuate the era of sin. And that era is past. That era was before Christ. Ever since Christ, you and I live in the era of grace. Sin should never be in our lips. It should never be on our minds. And eventually, if it's never in our lips or in our minds, eventually you're not going to see it in your bodies anymore. But it's an inside work working out. You've got to believe that first before you see it. Because Scripture says in Hebrews that the blood of Jesus washes us from a sin conscience. What does that mean to be washed from a sin conscience? We know what it means. We don't always think of ourselves as guilty. We don't always think of each other as guilty. We don't always think that we're messing up. Sometimes it's unfortunate because it seems like the most righteous of folks are the ones who beat themselves up the most. It seems like our love for God causes us to be tormented more than most. Because we love God so much, it breaks us that we have failed Him. I have failed you. I have failed you. And the Lord says, man, you are a royal pauper. He says, you are my child and you don't even live like it. You're saying that you failed me, and I say all failure has disappeared a long time ago. He says, if you will believe that and live like that, eventually these things will fall out of your body. Pay no attention to it. And I know that's hard to say sometimes, right? It's hard to say that because you listen to the evening news and you listen to all the sorry stories and you say, how can you say that? How can you say that? Listen, life has continued on this planet for 6,000 years, and the more we talk about the evil, the worse it seems to get. Stop talking about it. Stop calling the world evil. Stop calling everybody evil. Stop saying we're surrounded by destruction and sin. That era has passed. And if Adam is not a man who lived 6,000 years ago. Adam is our old thinking. If our old thinking brings in so much destruction, it says, how much more will Jesus Christ bring life? And this is a truth that will happen in your life and my life without our effort. Listen to this. If your old thinking torments you, and it has, right? Yes. My old thinking has told me time and time again that I have failed. I have failed God. I have made promises and vows and told and said I would stop doing this 1,000 times, but yet within my own human effort, I cannot stop doing certain things. Please somebody tell me I'm not alone. But as strong as my old thinking was to condemn me, that's why I say we're our worst enemies, our own worst enemies. As strong as my old thinking was to condemn me and banish me to hell, he says my new thinking, which is Christ, that's the new man, the new mind, my new thinking is so much more powerful than the old thinking. It's not even equal. Like the devil and Jesus, they're not equals. Like they're enemies, they're not enemies. The devil is the servant to Jesus. Jesus has no enemies. He has no one who is his equal. Nobody is the equal of God. Nobody. God blinks and everything happens. God can blink, and whoever you think the devil is, God can blink and the devil is gone. God has no equal. Isn't that amazing? As powerful as we thought the devil was, which is really our whole thing, how much more powerful, this scripture says, is the new man, the new mind, when you believe in the grace of God. When you actually believe in the grace of God, it's like one of those movies you see where you see like a bomb that just spreads across the whole plane and everything is vanquished. You're like, poof. That's the grace of God. Nothing had a chance against the grace of God. Sin has no chance. Guilt has no chance. Shame, your feelings of failure has no chance. If you grab hold of the grace of God, you will never ever wake up in the morning feeling sorry again. You will never again lay your head on the pillow thinking that you have failed. And I know that we live as royal paupers because we still haven't reconciled this grace issue. Can I get a witness? And we can go on and on with that. Somebody, let's read Psalm 103. I want us to see it in the New Testament as well as the Old Testament. God doesn't change. He was just as gracious before Christ. God, listen to this, everybody. Before you look at Psalms, listen to this. God did not change after he sent Jesus. It's not like God was angry. He sent Jesus and now he's not angry. That once again, we have a God who's angry. We have a God who changes. Our God doesn't change. God never changed. God was just as gracious and loving and forgiveness, and we were just as much children of God before Jesus. What Jesus brought to you and I, he rose us, he brought us from the dead is what he did. He made alive that thing that was always there. The Spirit of God inside all of us, the goodness and the grace of God was always there. It was just asleep or dead. Jesus says, when Jesus walked the earth, he said it means the same thing. He says, Lazarus is asleep. I said, he's not sleeping, he's dead. Jesus said, asleep, dead, it's the same thing. You have all of these things. It's just that Jesus makes them alive inside of you. See, God never changed. He was never angry, not even the Old Testament. I know we read the 10 plagues of Exodus. I know we read the fire and brimstone upon Sodom and Gomorrah, and we think of God as an angry God.
Not angry.
He hates evil, not people. He will destroy wickedness, but wickedness is not a person. Wickedness is a way we think, but it's not people. Because we are all the children of God. The wickedness that God hates is the things that is my wrong thinking that destroys my life. There are witnesses out there.
Amen.
So Psalms, we'll see, he didn't change. So who did not read yet? Somebody started verse 8, and let's read that Psalm passage.
He is merciful and tender toward those who don't deserve it. He is slow to get angry and full of kindness and love. He never bears a grudge. Lord, remain angry forever. He has not punished us as we deserve for all our sins. But his mercy toward those who fear and honor him is as great as the height of the heavens above the earth.
He has removed our sins as far away from us as the east is from the west. He is like a father to us, tender and sympathetic to those who reverence him. For he knows we are but dust, and that our days are few and brief, like grass and flowers, blown by the wind and gone away.
Look at that passage. It's written in the Old Testament, before Jesus came. We don't even have to go past verse 8. You all see verse 8? It says, he is merciful and tender toward who? Not those who deserve it. It says he is merciful towards those who what?
Who don't
deserve it. Who doesn't deserve it? Everybody who lives in Greece. Just in case we miss anybody in your family. Because I deserve all of the goodness of God. Well, sometimes I believe that, sometimes I don't. But sometimes, all too often, I'm quick to say that you don't deserve the goodness of God based upon what you do. And we say to each other, you're living under a curse, you're living with sickness, you're living with poverty because of what you've done. And that's not God. That's the God that we create. That's the royal pauper who's speaking there. Scripture doesn't say that. He says, what does it say there? You don't get, what does it say there? Okay. So you manufacture it? He says, he's tender towards those who don't deserve it. He's tender towards those who don't deserve it. All too often we think that the reward of heaven is based upon the obedience of the saints. It isn't. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that. It says every man will get according to what he has done. But remember, the every man, it's the Christ man. We just did the Adam and the Christ thing. Adam is dead, Christ is alive. Did Adam get what he deserved? He sure did. He got death. The old man got death. Everyone gets what he deserves. Everyone's going to get what they deserve in their body. The old man, Adam, is going to die. He died. He died in Jesus. All men died in Jesus. I am crucified with Christ. I died already. And until I realize I died already, I live as a royal pauper. Right? I did get what I deserved. But now I live as Christ. Now the Christ man, I'm crucified with Christ. Help me out. Nevertheless, I live. But it's not me who lives. But it's the Christ in me who now lives. The old man is dead. The new man now lives. So what's my reward as a new man? All of the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
That judgment stuff is all done already. But I don't believe this goodness because of what I see. That's the problem. Because of what we see, we don't believe. Faith is invisible. got to believe in something that you don't see. You know what I don't see sometimes? I don't see the righteous acts of the saints sometimes, but I still believe in them. Amen. And I live by faith. Thank God for that. So, everyone does get what he deserves. My old man got death. Jesus died for me. I didn't escape death. I died. Funny, it don't look like it. No, I died. And so did you. Your punishment deserves death. You got it. Now the new man, we live as this Christ man, and now we're looking at all the external things, and we're thinking, oh, you don't deserve this, you don't deserve that, and those are false understandings. So he's merciful and tender towards those who don't deserve it, human beings. He's slow to anger. He's full of kindness and love. Let's see, 10 is a good one. He has not punished us as we deserve for all of our sins. Who is the we? It's mankind. He has not punished us as we deserve for all of our sins. You know why he doesn't punish us? Because Jesus took our punishment. That's why he doesn't punish us. Jesus died for us. So what's left for you and me then? Nothing but the kingdom. The only thing left in front of all of humanity is the kingdom. Hell has been destroyed. It's a done issue. Listen, it's not that there was no hell. God destroyed it. Jesus went to hell for you. For who? For mankind. He went to hell for all mankind. Wherever you think hell is, he went to hell for you, so you don't have to go. Because he won't punish you. So why does anyone go to hell? It's punishment. But if Jesus took my punishment, that means he also went to hell for me. That means if he went to hell for me, if I'm going to hell, that means he didn't go to hell for me. I'm confused. I'm living as a royal pauper. That's the confusion. It's an oxymoron. I'm a king. I'm not a king. I'm guiltless. I'm going to hell. I'm going to heaven. It's the royal pauper. Because the grace of God is so good, it's almost too good to be true. And that is the thinking of the vast majority of human beings. So, let's go on. I want to just skip over Roman numeral number 2 and just look at Roman numeral number 3. The truth of the matter is right there in 1 John 3:1. Somebody read that and help us nice, loud, and clear. What did that say?
How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are.
Hey, dude! Hey. How great is the love of the Father that he has lavished his love on us. I think we sing that song. That we should be called, what are we called? The children of God. That is what we are. That is what we are. All God's children. Read that passage with me. So to whom does God offer his gift? To the brightest? The most beautiful or the most charming? We all say, no. No. His gift is for us all. Beggars and bankers, clergy and clerks, judges and prisoners, we are all God's children. How great is the love of the Father that we should be called the children of God. Stop living like a royal pauper. The next paragraph, and he wants us so badly, he'll take us in any condition. As is, reads the tag on our collars. Great. He's not about to wait for us to reach perfection. Woo! That's a good one. Do you think he's waiting for you to overcome temptation? I haven't done it yet. That's me. I don't know how you're doing. I know he ain't waiting for me. He already made me a child, but I still don't overcome the temptations. So is he waiting for us to overcome all temptations?
No.
Hardly. Hardly. Is he waiting for us when we master the Christian walk? Good, that's confidence. Far from it. Remember, Christ died for us while we were still sinners. His sacrifice then was not dependent on our performance. Our performance gets us nothing. We have everything because of Jesus, and because of that, he will cause us to do good works. We do good works because of what Jesus has done for us. It doesn't mean that we're void of good works, okay? It doesn't mean we're void of good works. It's just that our good works doesn't get us anything. Huh, we are not royal paupers. You already have everything. You don't get it when you start to live right. You already have it all while you're living wrong. And some of you say, how dare you? How dare you? Tell me I'm living wrong. Nerve of you, I'm sitting in this holy house. You are not judged righteous based upon your performance. So yes, you can live like the devil and still receive the kingdom of heaven, but it's just not going to happen that way. When you receive the goodness of God by divine nature, you just start to live, to love, to forgive. You can't stop it. You can't teach it. You can't stop it. You can't unleash it. You can't unlock it. You can't open up the books of life. Amen? Yeah. Our performance doesn't get us anything. But it doesn't mean that our performance doesn't matter. It does matter. But it's the work of Christ in our life that causes us by nature to do good things. It's the picture of the fruit tree. You know, how does an orange tree produce oranges? It just does by nature. And by nature, you're going to produce love, gentleness, kindness, goodness. It's just the fruit of the Spirit which lives inside of you. And then you got these other passages there which are good to reaffirm that it's the work of God in our lives. But you are no longer a royal pauper. 1 Peter, you are no longer a royal pauper. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. For his own special people, you are his own special people. And then with that understanding, we will proclaim the praises of him who called us, because he called us out of darkness into Michael Kozlowski. His marvelous light. Amen. Rise, all sons of the King, rise. You can rise. I dub thee knights of the round table. Paupers vanquished for eternity. Well, Michael, would you honor us with a closing prayer?
Yes. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing us here this evening, Lord, to partake of your words of truth, your words of love, your words of grace, Lord. Help us, Father, to spread this light and this love to all that we meet as you're changing our hearts and making us all new. The image of your Son, Jesus Christ, everybody says.
Amen. God bless you all. Stay for a cup of coffee, everybody.